Hello, everybody. In the next couple of minutes, I will tell you about the CyberSOC methodology and later on the CyberSOC software that we developed to empirically measure the operational performance of a Cybersecurity Operations Center, or short, SOC. My name is Martin Rosso. I'm one of the authors and a PhD student at Eindhoven University of Technology from the Netherlands. Before I talk a bit more about why measuring operational SOC performance is a hard problem that we should solve, let me give you a very brief summary of how SOCs work internally. So SOCs are often organized in tiers. A tier one analyst looks at incoming alerts and they try to identify attacks. Once they are sure that they spotted an attack and they collected enough evidence, they hand over the case to a tier two analyst. And the tier two analyst will then investigate and try to find out the details. For example, what devices were compromised, when, how, and what steps do we need to do? That, of course, sounds rather simple, attack identification and attack investigation. But, of course, it is not as easy as it sounds in the real world. In the real world, SOCs are very complex. Under the hood, there is technology, processes, and the human SOC operators. And they are all parts or components that need to work together to run a successful SOC. Measuring the performance of all the individual components and parts and putting them in context is hard. So, well, just imagine you want to make a better SOC, for example, by switching to a new SIEM solution, or you ask your SOC operators to try new alert handling policies or processes. How do you know that the changes you made had a positive impact on the operational SOC performance? What if your changes actually had a negative impact on your SOC performance? CyberSOC addresses this problem with a very simple idea. We inject synthetic modular attacks to evaluate SOC performance as a whole. So now let me introduce you to the CyberSOC methodology. I will go through it one step after another. In the center, you see the SOC. CyberSOC does not interfere with the normal SOC operation, so SOC operation continues as usual. The first component of the CyberSOC methodology is the attack trace library. It contains small snippets of network traffic featuring various activities from real or simulated cyber attacks. Some attack traces contain reconnaissance actions like stealthy port scans, less stealthy port scans, address scans. Another library section may contain attack traces about initial compromises. For example, there's an attacker that runs an exploit against the victim, or it's an inside attacker that just knows the password of a victim server. And then maybe there's another attack trace library section that features command and control activities. In fact, we use the MITRE ATT&CK framework to keep the library well structured into sections. The second component is the attack generation. Here we assemble attacks from individual attack traces from the library. So, for example, we take a port scan from the reconnaissance section of the library. We take an exploit from the initial access library section. Maybe we take a second exploit because the first one didn't work. And in the end, we add some command and control activity. Here we need to make sure that attack traces are in a plausible logical order, and to do that we again use the MITRE ATT&CK framework. Lastly, we ensure that IP addresses are coherent, meaning that the attack traces have all the same attacker and victim IP addresses. The next phase is the attack injection, and as the name suggests, we take the assembled attack and we inject it into the network intrusion detection sensors. Eventually, the alerts will be generated and will pop up in the SOC, and the tier 1 analysts will look at them. They will hopefully identify an attack and give the case to tier 2 analysts for further investigation. Lastly, tier 2 analysts will write a report. We will fetch this report. We will compare it to the attack we initially injected. Remember that we created the attack ourselves in phase 2, and thus we know all the details that we expect in the report, so we have the ground truth. I would like to point out that this methodology can be used without interrupting normal SOC operations. To validate our methodology, we conducted an experiment. We need to show that we can measure the difference in terms of operational performance between two SOCs. So we created two SOCs with a slightly different configuration. We set up two SOC servers, one I will call good SOC, the other one bad SOC. Bad SOC is the out-of-the-box experience of the Security Onion SIEM software. And to get good SOC, we disabled or suppressed high-priority alerts related to policy violations. Policy violations do not indicate attacks, and they are completely irrelevant in context of a university SOC. So it is realistic to disable those. We expect to observe that good SOC is better than bad SOC in terms of attack identification, because there is simply less distraction caused by the policy violation alerts. But otherwise, the SOCs are identical, so the attack investigation should be completely identical in both SOCs. And then what we did is we assigned pairs of students to either of the two SOC servers or SOC conditions, and we injected real network traffic as well as two attacks that we crafted ourselves. Lastly, we asked our students to report their findings using an online questionnaire. To summarize, we have a realistic setup, we have a real SIEM, we have real network traffic, and our students assumed the role of SOC analysts. In this slide, let me give you an introduction to the two attacks that we injected. On the left side, you see all the alerts generated by the Mirai attack. The Mirai attack is a bit easier to detect because it generates more alerts. It is named after the Mirai botnet. On the right-hand side of the slide, you see the alerts generated by the XSIM attack, our second attack. And the XSIM attack is named after the XSIM mail server because the core component here is an exploit against the XSIM mail server. What the two attacks have in common, though, is their general structure. So both attacks started with the attacker scanning the potential victims, either a bit more stealthy or a bit less stealthy. Then the attacker compromised the victim. In the Mirai attack, the attacker knew the password because it was a default password. And in the XSIM case, the attacker had an exploit against an unpatched version of the XSIM mail server on the victim. And then lastly, the victim shows some suspicious post-compromise command and control activities where it connects to a command and control server. Now let's switch over to the results of our experiment. This graph summarizes the differences between bad SOC in blue and good SOC in orange with respect to the attack identification phase. So as a reminder, attack identification means that students spotted an alert and mentioned it in their report. And in this graph, you can see the total number or the fraction of the number of groups that reported the Mirai attack, the XSIM attack, both attacks together, and of course, the number of groups that did not mention any of the two attacks in their report. You can see that the groups operating on good SOC in orange were more likely to identify the XSIM attack and both attacks. In fact, the differences here are significant. Now let's continue to the attack investigation. For all the reports that identified one of the two attacks we injected, we also looked at the quality of the report, meaning the attack investigation. Now we have two charts, one for each of the two attacks we injected. On the left side, you see the chart for the Mirai attack. We further divided the analysis into the three attack phases: the reconnaissance phase, the compromise phase, where the attacker initially compromised the victim, and then the post-compromise command and control activities. As you can see, for neither of the two attacks, we were able to observe any significant differences in operational SOC performance between good SOC and bad SOC. This is, of course, not surprising because, as I mentioned earlier, the good SOC and bad SOC configuration were completely identical with exception to the disabled alerts. That means that It should be easier for good SOC operators to identify an attack, but not to investigate it. Now that we know that the methodology works, let me present the CyberSOC software, user-friendly software built on top of the CyberSOC methodology. On screen, you can see the CyberSOC web interface. On the left side of the screen, you see the attack trace library. It is ordered by the MITRE ATT&CK framework again. From here, with the click of a button, you can add individual attack traces to the timeline where you can assemble an attack. On the timeline, you can drag and drop items around as you please. Once you are happy with the attack, you can generate and inject it using the buttons in the upper right corner, which will replay the attack on the connected network interfaces. Lastly, I would like to point out that there is much more around CyberSOC. We do have a repository where you can find a VirtualBox virtual machine with a 15 to 20 minutes hands-on quick start experience. We have a very documented API that is even more powerful than the web interface. You can find the full source code, including an extensive manual and documentation, of course. So feel free to have a look at gitlab.tue.nl/cybersoc. Thank you very much, and of course, I'm available for further questions.